I'll start to give you a brief intro of EPI, this European Processor Initiative that you may have heard a bit about, which is going to make, let's say, lots of noise in the next weeks. And then I will present you my, let's say, challenges in terms of converting this H2020 research program as a product, because we need to have something in the, on the market in 2021 to be part of, let's say, the huge Euro HPC challenge. So I said my background, it's 20 years of semiconductor business. I've done tons of product, the last one being in 28 nanometer, and now part of this EPI challenge is to build a high-class 7 nanometer processor. You will see it's not easy. Now we have the best guys in town to help us. So let's bet that in 4 years from now, we'll have it. So first, in terms of background, we are going to discuss about, let's say, multiple keywords. And EPI, which is basically an H2020 program, has been built on sovereignty, AI, and computing, with the idea of getting rid or limiting all the dependencies to, let's say, US, mainly US, and Chinese components. You will see that's not easy every day. And as far as I'm concerned, that's basically my main challenge today. So lots of buzzwords on this slide. See, it's clear it's sovereignty, computing science, but you see that we are going to cover a bit in terms of, let's say, automotive, safety, security, etc., and elements like this. And EPI is basically everything about this. So first, let's say mission about EPI. I said it's to be independent in terms of technology, because today, when you take a supercomputer, or when let's say a supercomputing maker is building one machine, most of the parts are, let's say, coming from US. And today the challenge is to get rid of these dependencies and ensure that the exascale machine in Europe, let's say beyond 2023, and let's say the first small one in 2021, will limit these dependencies to ensure that basically part of the business, the margin, will see this out of it. And we have the best use of the European fund basically to source equipments or part of the equipments in Europe. Now, what's also new to this program is that European Commission and all the industry on board, they want this program to be converted as a product. So it means that the best use of, let's say, the budget, and ensure that ideally this business can fly on its own later on. So of course, at the beginning, we need lots of subsidies. And you need subsidies to have your, let's say, your research effort working. But the idea beyond this program, let's say we start with lots of help of public budget at the beginning, but let's say after 4 years, we want to be almost able to fly on our own. And the only way to do it is to merge two businesses, the HPC, which is bringing basically the high performances, the sovereignty, and lots of public effort, and the car business, especially related to autonomous drive, etc., that will need lots of embedded computing. But the difference in between the second one and the first one, in between the car business and the HPC business, is that the second one brings volume and brings potentially, of course, if we have the good offer, a market that could be self-sufficient and be able, let's say, to provide enough cash to build the next generation. So the way we want to do it, and that's the EPI vision, it's a family of processors, first for high performances computing. That's the mandate number one, and this one has to be, let's say, efficient in production in 2021, which is, let's say, more than 3 years from now. The second one, I said, is to sync it with the need of ADAS, embedded computing. At the beginning, we thought it was completely crazy to manage both almost at the same time, because the need for HPC and autonomous drive may be a bit different, but finally, knowing how long are the development cycle in the automotive business, and knowing that what you will have in a car in 2035, it's still some products that have to be developed or initiated today. So the cycles are huge. So it means that think about the needs in terms of embedded processing in autonomous car in 2035, and that's something we have to initiate now. which means that the computing need in, let's say, 15 years from now in such a car will be quite of kind of crazy, and in fact quite close to what is needed in the HPC today. So of course with a different number of chipset, etc., but quite quite close. A third dimension that will be explored later is in terms of server, cloud, etc., but this one is also quite challenging in terms of business because there are, let's say, most of stakeholders on this market already. And we keep this, let's say, as a third step. The key one is to be good for the first one, HPC, and the second one for ADAS. And if possible, not if possible, let's say, it's key to manage synergies in both markets. And so for the one of you in your labs, etc., involved in the, let's say, EPI design, think in terms of both. Because today we care about computing power, low power, but tomorrow we are going to care about safety, reliability, self-configuration, and plenty of new stuff you have to think in terms of architecture. Now, where is EPI and EST that we are going to discuss after? You may have been posted about your HPC. So your HPC, that's a huge European program to, let's say, develop exascale machine. And EPI, which is this consortium, going to develop some IP. EST, that's the fabless company that's going to put this chip on the market. Now, a chip is not enough to build a machine. You need the middleware, you need the chassis, you need the software, you need the elements, and of course, you need lots of public budget here to ensure that it flies. So your HPC, it's more than 1 billion euros of budget, and EPI and EST are the one involved in the chip design. Now, today, which partner are part of EPI? So we have 23 officially on the list. We have 32 candidates from China to US, and of course, lots of Europeans waiting to help us. That's the first batch, which is likely to be announced, let's say, increased later on. So here you have, let's say, compelling companies focused on HPC, servers, etc. You have compelling research center, academics, etc. We have the best of what is possible in Europe to build the best in class processor. And you can see that some are focused on automotive, some are focused on HPC, etc. So we cover a wide scope, which is basically what we need to be successful in 21 in HPC and 23 in 23-25 in automotive. Now, in terms of European geography, we are going, let's say, from the western part, Portugal, to the eastern part, which is Greece. So today I'm doing this in Greece, but next month I have an FX keynote in Portugal to introduce also the program. And in December, it will be, let's say, our first launchpad in the automotive industry in Paris. So it's quite wide, quite pan-European. And you may see that it's a bit challenging to manage, especially if you want a product out of it. Yes, but that's the bet I took and will be successful on it. Now, I would like to give you, let's say, a couple pictures about the challenges we are going to face. Because moving from IP to a finished product, which is not, by the way, not only a chip, but a full solution, because you need the SDK, the compiler, reference boards, etc., is quite challenging. You have a huge gap in between what most of you are used today, IPs, both software, hardware, etc., and what is needed on the market. And the big EPI challenge is to move from both, let's say, from the left side to the right side as soon as possible. So if we start with EPI consortium, which is described here, so I said it's a mix of best guys from the industry, the automotive, and the research, 10 countries represented in Europe that will animate the EPI ecosystem, and most of them are basically IP providers. So they will give us some components in terms of hardware, software, compiler, test app, elements of middleware, etc., which are needed for this fabless company, EST, that has been set up this summer to integrate the parts, to finish the chip, to market it, and to put it on the market. That's one of the step which is needed, because the customer behind, they care about basically a chip which is ready to be shipped and ready to be integrated into their platform. And part of the European mandate we have is, let's say, multiple products we have to cover, and this has to be available end of 21. It starts from, let's say, PCI board, server boards, HPC blade, and an ADAS prototype. This ADAS prototype is going to be a bit oversized because we are going to use an HPC chip to do it, but it has to be, in end of 21, a fully autonomous BMW that will use this platform. In the meantime, lots of OEMs, and this is valid, let's say, from China to US, start to care about this platform because they understood that if they want to be able to ship, let's say, beyond 2021, something in Europe, it has to be based on this platform. Or let's say they will have much more chances to have a local business or European business if they design out of this, if they design with this chip. So we discuss HPC, we discuss automotive. That's, let's say, the first step. AI and big data, it's kind of built-in because we'll have lots of IP built-in to address this technology. Now, knowing that we'll be able to do automotive with lots of safety critical functions, it means that space and industry 4.0, which is the next wave after automotive, will be quite easy to get. But I said the first focus is on this one. But the spirit of this common platform we are, let's say, designing together is to ensure that at the end we can have a wide scope. And also one key point behind that, knowing the cost of the technology and knowing the cost of what we have to develop, you cannot address, let's say, these multiple segments with platforms which are absolutely independent. So the level of expenses, knowing that we are talking about, let's say, hundreds of millions euros per segment, you cannot multiply the program. It has to be combined, if possible, in both. So in terms of roadmap, it gives us this basically view. What you have in blue here, it's the so-called common platform, which we are going to integrate lots of IPs, let's say, coming from Europe, and I will explain to you later the challenges, with the main target of having, let's say, in production, so it's a finished goods, finished product that will be shipped part of, let's say, pre-exascale machine in 21. So this chip family will be based on ARM, let's say, pending to the final deal which are about to have, RISC-V technology, quite, let's say, important today in the research industry, that for pre-exascale and this automotive proof of concept with BMW. The interest of this common platform is that first we are going to integrate external IPs. Some research labs and partners will use this common platform to test and prove the functionalities of their own IPs. So it's a kind of launching pad for our IPs, but so a launching pad to be in production with our IP and, let's say, make licenses or royalties out of it. The second generation, a bit more challenging. So first one, 7 nanometer. Second one, 5 nanometers, because this will be quite mainline for data processing in 23, exascale and automotive. Third one, it's still at concept level, will be a mix of ARM, RISC-V, and technology need at this time. So far, it's still fuzzy. Now, if we zoom one level in within this family, and at this stage, I can disclose a bit of the elements. So, ARM technology is also pending, let's say, to the final deal, which is today a fast track to have something at production level in 2021, but lots of investments also around RISC-V technology, some elements related for the built-in accelerator, for root of cost, because we need some, let's say, security dimension, and in terms of power management. Because when you have an architecture which is mini-core, the power management and the way you wake up the different cores is quite critical. To ensure that the common platform will become also a nice tool in terms of research and to do some of the developments, a European FPGA technology will be embedded. So it means that you, as, let's say, research labs or industry on board, will have the possibility to develop, to customize a bit the platform according to your needs and prepare your own IPs that will be integrated on the next on the next one. So, to summarize on this part, what do we expect out of this at the end? Yeah, sovereignty, this was the, let's say, the minimum we have to do, protect the data, avoid embargo from, let's say, non-European providers, because this happened, and this is likely to happen again. We are trying to move also to a NITAR-free solution. It's going to be challenging, but we are doing, let's say, we're doing our best to save it. So, which means independent from, let's say, independent from US and Chinese provider, how to create value in Europe out of this. Even if we cannot build 100% of the platform in Europe, we need to address lots of IPs and lots of elements in Europe. I'll go back to this after, which basically, of course, creates jobs and technology. And if you follow what Airbus did, let's say, years ago, it was a bit this way. So at the beginning, they had, lots of local technologies, and finally, it's more and more. And there is also something which is quite key in the supercomputing business, is that today, when you manufacture a supercomputer, so it's high-class machine, and high-class in terms of budget, because we are talking, let's say, of budget from 50 to 300 million euros each, a large amount of the machine cost is spent in terms of CPU and RAM. So the RAM is beyond the scope, and today there is no choice in Europe. The CPU said the challenge is to limit the dependencies, and the more margin we have in Europe, for the CPU, the better it will be. Today, when we source one chip to Intel or one chip to Nvidia, it's clear that this budget is going to US. When, from 2021, European HPC or server makers will source this product in Europe, part of the margin will stay in Europe and will create some local job instead of remote job. So now that's the perfect plan, and let's see that in the real life, it's a bit more challenging than this. And let's see together how, and especially you, in your case, you could help us to have, much more European DNA and European spirit in this chip. First, a business figure that you may have seen this diagram a couple times. This is an updated version, so the amounts have been reduced a bit. That's the cost of technology. Today, developing a platform in 7 nanometers, you have an average cost of $300 million. Yeah, that's a lot. But based on what I spent on my previous program in terms of 28 nanometers, I can guarantee that this is realistic. Even if at the beginning I have some doubts, okay, so you're not going to, multiply by 6 your budget from 28 to 7 nanometer. And that's what I thought at the beginning. But in fact, part of this, EPI genesis, we have started to quote, with IP vendors, EDA tools vendors, etc. And the total cost we have to spend in terms of 4 years to build this platform, yes, we are definitely close to it. So the challenge is that it needs lots of cash. And keep this in mind, because when in your lab, great lab, by the way, that you are, building some IPs, the turnaround from your IP to this 7 nanometer, it's going to take a while that we are trying to reduce, and it's going to take millions. So the closer you are to the final product in terms of spirit and the way you think about it, the faster will be my route to convert it as a product. Now, another example, before seeing the European dependencies, if you check my long-haul travel plan in the first 15 months of this project, you may see that something is a bit weird in this. Lots of time in US, lots of time in Taiwan, Japan, Korea. To manage a European program and to source some European IPs, it sounds a bit weird. But yes, that's a fact. No choice, because today building a solution which is 100% European is absolutely out of the questions, and maybe later with a couple billion euros spent in terms of subsidies to build fabs, etc., we'll be able to do it, but today it's challenging. So what's wrong? First, you may see, especially for the one involved in this chip design, that we need a core, we need a NUC, we need a RISC-V CPU, etc., but that's not enough. You still need memory controllers, you need IOs, PCI, and lots of stuff to communicate with the external world. And today, if you check carefully, these IPs are no longer in Europe. Or if they are in Europe, they are not necessarily very competitive. Or if to have some which are proven, we have to source it mainly in US or in some cases in Asia. To design a chip, you need some EDA tools. You may not see this here because for the one involved in chip design, you have some Euro practice license, etc. For you, it's free. When you build a product out of it, you need to spend lots of money. And here also, we are talking about $1 million basically to have the license for it. And also a budget which is leaving Europe. Or for, let's say, among the three providers, there is one which is in Europe, the two others are US. So also that's a budget which is gone. Now, in terms of fab, you know that what's left in Europe, it's basically 28 nanometer in the Alps, 22 in Germany. Thinking about data processing, we need the best in terms of density, the best in terms of low power. You can no longer work with this process. You're obliged to move one step up, or let's say one generation ahead, two generation ahead, which means basically today 7 nanometer. In tomorrow, it will be 5. And for this, it's Taiwan or Korea. The fourth point in terms of investment, when you're not in California or not in China, let's say leveraging $1 million to build your chip, to build your platform, that's another challenge. First, we are talking in dollars, which is not a good sign. And most of the VCs and investors basically have left Europe for this. So he said, how could you do it? And why I'm going to spend the next 4 years or 5 years on this program and the execution behind? It's because we are smarter than what they think. And it was in terms of French joke, it was a couple years, no, let's say now it's 30 years ago, something like this, with the first oil crisis in 1973 or 1975. The French word was, on n'a pas de pétrole, mais on a des idées. So we no longer have oil, but we have ideas, and we'll have to do it the same way. So it means that with some key IPs, key architecture, we have ways to compensate. But now, please help me to, let's say, facilitate my IP to product conversion. So here you have a panorama, a snapshot of the different elements which are needed to build a chip. So IPs, you are here. But it's not enough. Because I said I need memory controller, I need PCI controller, I need lots of PHY, etc. So this is beyond Europe. Now, in terms of architecture, design team, that's clear, we have. And not bad. Design tools, it's much more challenging. We have one of the three, let's say, EDA vendors. For the rest, we are obliged to source in US. Backend, packaging, subcontractor, especially for this class of technology where the layout is quite complex, the packaging is complex, there are not so many serious candidates able to do it, so it ends to US, Taiwan, Korea. This is going to be tough to change. Last one, fab, Taiwan, Korea, for the class of technology we need. So you see, it's a long way. Let's say multiple flags which are not necessarily European, but at least we have this and we have this, which is a good compensation if we're able to create value out of it. So keep in mind these two elements. For the rest, I let this to the, let's say, European Commission to help us in, improving this, which will take years, and the others are quite, let's say, ahead on it. Another way you could help us in terms of design, I said, so when you're thinking in terms of IP architecture, think a bit in terms of product and what could be the use of it, and ensure that when you develop it or you propose it part of a European project, you're getting close to the result and not too early in terms of research. If not, the conversion time will be tough and we'll be obliged basically to source this in other places. And to finish, it's not an economic lecture, but you have to understand a couple points. So when an industry, for instance, a server maker is buying a chip, so where the cost distribution is going, you have the fab and test codes, which is today non-European. You have part of the IPs which are not in Europe, so I need to license them, pay my royalties out of it. So one part of the margin is left for Europe. So this is not on scale, of course, it's not necessarily one third, it can be more, it can be less. depending on some parameters. And out of this margin, two elements: IP tools and automatization. That's where you could, you could work with, good IPs, good license, good patent. You could have, benefits out of it. And which ends to the raw margin, which is basically left for Europe. So help us to maximize this. Forget the fab, forget the elements. We cannot do it. Think in terms of IP and think in terms of production. And finally, to go back to EPI as a conclusion, they did this 20 or 25 years ago. Airbus was, kind of science fiction at this time. Finally, they did it, half of the market. What the European Commission is expecting beyond this EPI program to set up or to create the next Intel, but in Europe this time. Two milestones, summarized: 21 for the first product, 23 for the second generation in the car business, and car business is quite significant in Europe. And now, thanks to you, let's try to make European HPC European again, and this needs advanced SoC, and this needs design, if possible, in Europe. Thanks for your attention.